In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Good morning. Welcome to our celebration of the fifth Sunday of Lent. And we join with the catechumens all over the church in our final scrutiny, asking ourselves, what is it that should die within us, and what is it that should come to life from us? I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, your Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Kyrie eleison, Christe.
Thank you.
been saved, raised up, and redeemed. The realm of the flesh is the realm to be left behind. And the realm of the spirit is where true life is to be found. The indwelling of the spirit refers to the baptism of the person and its consequent moral life. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans.
Brothers and sisters, those who are in the flesh cannot please God, but you are not in the flesh. On the contrary, you are in the Spirit. If only the Spirit of God dwells in you, whoever does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. If the Spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, the one who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also, through his Spirit dwelling in you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died.
in me, even if he dies, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?
Yes, Lord. I have come to believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, the one who is coming into the world.
Take the stone away.
As soon as she heard this, she rose quickly and went to him. For Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still where Martha had met him. So when the Jews who were with her in the house comforting her saw Mary get up quickly and go out, they followed her, presuming that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet.
Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died.
When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come with her weeping, he became perturbed and deeply troubled.
Where have you laid him?
They said to him, Sir, come and see. And Jesus wept. So the Jews said, See how he loved him? But some of them said, Could not the one who opened the eyes of the blind man have done something so that this man would not have died? So Jesus, perturbed again, came to the tomb. It was a cave. And a stone lay across it.
Take the stone away, come out, come out. Take the stone away, come out.
Take away the stone.
Lord, by now there will be a stench. She has been dead for 4 days.
Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?
So they took away the stone, and Jesus raised his eyes.
Father, I thank you for hearing me. I know that you always hear me. But because of the crowd here, I've said this, that they may believe that you sent me.
And when he had said this, he cried out in a loud voice,
Lazarus, come out!
Take the stone away!
Jesus performs 7 signs or miracles to reveal his power as the Son of God. The very first sign is at the wedding in Cana, where Jesus changes water into wine, and the people begin to believe in him. And today we have the 7th and the last sign, where Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead. And ironically, even as Jesus is revealing his power as the Son of God over death, it is this very miracle that leads to his own death. In the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, it is the cleansing of the temple that angers the Jewish leadership, and they end up arresting Jesus and finally having him crucified. There are 3 very important things for us to keep in mind in our gospel today, on this 5th Sunday of Lent. The first is the range of emotions that we see in Jesus facing the death of his friend Lazarus. We are told that Jesus was perturbed and troubled twice. And in the Greek translation, of those words, perturbed and troubled,
at death and what death can do to families and to a community. And at the same time, we're told that Jesus wept. He experienced sadness and sorrow at the death of his friend Lazarus. And so in this way, Jesus goes through the whole gamut of emotions that you and I also experience when a loved one dies. I'm sure there's nobody here who has not experienced the death of a loved one, whether it is a parent or a grandparent, a child or a sibling, or a friend, or a neighbor, or a member of the community. We've all experienced loss and death. And therefore, we too have gone through these emotions that Jesus expresses in the gospel today. The second most important thing in the gospel for us to keep in mind is the dialogue between Martha and Jesus. Martha says to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." And Jesus used every sign and miracle to teach and to invite people to eternal life. And so Jesus says to Martha, "I am the resurrection and the life. Martha, do you believe this?" And Martha comes through and says, "Yes, I do believe." So even in the situations and events of death that we face in our lives, we have to go through a grieving process, because that is the human thing to do. But afterwards, and deep down, you and I are Martha. And Jesus says to you and me, "I am the resurrection and the life. Your brother will rise. Do you believe this?" What will I respond? And then we have the third important aspect of the gospel today, where everybody comes to believe in Jesus. We know that even Mary asked the same thing of Jesus, like Martha did. She said, "If you had been here, my brother would not have died." But Mary is the contemplative one, while Martha is practically asking about her brother Lazarus. Mary is asking about all of us who grieve the loss of a loved one. And Jesus teaches us the same. "I am the resurrection and the life. And do you believe this?" And all the people come forward and say, like Martha, "Yes, I do believe that you are the Son of the living God." So there are five sacred tasks for somebody who's dying, or for our loved ones who have to watch over somebody who's dying. And what are these five sacred tasks? The first is, "I love you." The second is, "Thank you." Thank you for something specific, or thank you in general. The third sacred task is, "I am sorry." And the fourth sacred task is, "I forgive you." And the final one is, "Goodbye," which in old English means, "God be with you." That is our final wish for our loved one who's dying, and that is also the final wish of our loved one for us, who will then remain in his or her memory. These are our five sacred tasks. Because they're so important, I don't want you to forget them. So what is the first sacred task? "I love you." What is the second? "Thank you." Thank you for something specific, or thank you for something in general. The third? "I am sorry." The fourth?
"I forgive you."
"I forgive you." And finally?
Son is the Lord and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess my baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. We express our belief in eternal life as we bring our prayers to the Lord.
Our response is, Jesus, make our hearts like yours.
Jesus, make our hearts like yours.
For Pope Francis, for Bishop McGrath, for Father George, may they continue to spread the love and mercy of Jesus, we pray.
Jesus, make our hearts like yours.
For Bishop Daly, as he prepares to shepherd the people of the Diocese of Spokane, for the divided peoples of Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, Iraq, for peace across the wider Middle East, for those who are persecuted because of their faith, for refugees and uprooted families, for all living in camps and for those who assist them, and for all who have been bereaved, injured, and traumatized, we pray.
Jesus, make our hearts yours.
For all men and women, may they come to recognize the healing presence of God in their lives through our witness as a parish community, and turn back to the church, we pray.
Jesus, make our hearts like yours.
For all victims of human trafficking and child exploitation, for those who enable their redemption and recovery, for those who oppress them, and for ourselves, that our parish community will respond in prayer during the next 10 days, we pray.
Jesus, in our hearts like yours.
For our elect, who are preparing for the sacraments of baptism, confirmation, and Eucharist, for our candidates preparing for the sacraments of confirmation and Eucharist, for the children preparing for confirmation and Eucharist during the Easter season, may God deepen their faith, their oneness with the community, and their call to mission. We pray.
Jesus,
for our fellow parishioners, friends, and family who are sick, today we pray for Virgilio Castro, Lourdes del Rosario, Jenny Flagg, John Hedberg, Gina Paelli, for those who have asked for our prayers, and for those who care for the sick, for those who are dying, may they feel the support of our prayers. We pray.
Jesus, make our hearts like yours.
For those who have died, Jim Brennan, Catherine Eddins, Barbara Longinati, Joseph McTaggart, Jeff Naluka, for the 22 people killed in Tunisia, for the 14 killed in Pakistan, for all the dead, may Jesus, who wept at the loss of his friend Lazarus, raise them up to the abundant life of heaven and console those they have left behind. We pray.
Jesus, make our hearts like yours.
Let us pause for a moment of silence before our own personal experience of death among our loved ones, as well as for all those who died in the world. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon them, and may they rest in peace. Amen. disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory."
Triumphed over death to be the source of our life and resurrection.
Blessed are we who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
Affecting 2.4 million people on every continent in our world.
50% of which are children under 18 years old.
Victims of human trafficking often come from vulnerable populations, including migrants, oppressed or marginalized groups, foster care and at-risk children, runaways or homeless persons, and the extremely poor.
In the United States, sex trafficking commonly occurs in online escort services, residential brothels, brothels disguised as massage businesses or spas, and in-street prostitution. Labor trafficking has been found in domestic servitude situations, as well as sales crews, large farms, restaurants, hotels, carnivals, nail salons, and more.
We have learned that trafficking is not just a concern around the world, but is happening here in our own county and city. In fact, an estimated 43% of all human trafficking cases in the state of California occurred in the Bay Area. This issue is so big, it can be paralyzing.
The Bay Area Anti-Trafficking Coalition suggests taking a time-oriented approach that starts by asking yourself, what can you do in 10 minutes, 10 days, and 10 months to fight trafficking? Following this 10-10-10 philosophy, this group of parishioners came up with the idea to join together with the rest of our parish as a community to pray for an end to human trafficking. We have decided to pray for 10-minute sections for the 10 days leading up to Holy Thursday. Tomorrow night, March 23rd, there will be a prayer vigil at 7 p.m. to kick off this 10 days of prayer, which will run from 8 p.m. Monday evening through 8 p.m. on Holy Thursday, when we begin our celebration of the Trinity.
So we are asking each person to sign up for at least one 10-minute slot during the 24-hour period of a day to pray for this cause. We are encouraging you to pray during the same time slot for each one of the 10 days. If you would like to sign up for a half hour or an hour each day, that would be great too. Prayers may be said from any location you are in, and we will provide you with some suggested types of prayer to help guide you.
Sign-up sheets will be at the tables in the vestibule after Mass. We will be there to answer any questions you may have. Help us form a prayer chain to break the chains of human trafficking.
So please stop at the table in the vestibule after Mass to sign up. And there will also be more information on our parish website regarding the 10-10-10 philosophy from the Bay Area Anti-Trafficking Coalition. Thank you.
Our Mass is ended. Let us go in the peace of the Lord.
Thank you, God.